Welcome back to another episode where I'm interviewing award-winning national trial lawyer Nick Rowley. This is episode 2 of 3, which means that if you haven't seen the previous episodes, we got to catch you up to speed. So I'll provide links to those episodes down in the description. And if you go down in that description, what you'll also find are links to Nick's books and ways to follow him as well. And if I can ask for one simple favor, if you find yourself enjoying this interview, then be sure to hit the like button down below. Doing so allows the video to rank higher so we can reach more people and ultimately help more people. That's always the goal. Now, with all this out of the way, let's get back into the interview with Nick Rowley. So what you just said is interesting. A question just popped up in my mind. Mm-hmm. Do you totally internalize the jury trial lawyer as your identity? Or are you able to turn it off and on as needed as you navigate through life?
Wow, that's one of the most interesting questions I think I've had thrown at me. Let me think about that.
Yeah.
I do internalize it. Yeah, it's very much my identity. Mm-hmm. Very much. Shutting it off is hard. It's very difficult. It's a tough thing to do. When I shut off my devices, I try to do it as often as I can. I just get away from everything. Sometimes I'll go, 5, 6 days with no computer, and I'll, have my phone set aside and won't mess with it. People can't get a hold of me, and spend time with my kids. Then I'm able to shut it off. Kinda.
There are times where I have to actively try and shut off my lawyer mode. My wife's a lawyer as well. And she ended up graduating law school a year after I did. So as I was a year ahead of her, and she was interested in mock trial, I was the one who was showing her everything I learned about cross-examination and things like that. And there are times where her and I are getting at it, and she's giving me a hard time. And I realize, you're cross-examining me right now. Like I taught you that. But I have to turn it off because I'm like, there's no way I win this. There's no way I like come back and overcome what's going on right now. So I'm just going to take my blows and move on.
So do you argue like intelligent people or like five-year-olds?
Oh, between the two of us?
Yeah.
I'd say probably intelligent people more often than not. Fun fact, I don't know what it is about trash TV, but we found that like one of the foundations to our entire marriage is somehow watching trash TV that we developed watching during COVID. And as a result of that, we'll pause it and we'll try and like think about the psychology of somebody making certain decisions. Then we just start kind of debating. Next thing we know, we're talking about religion and all these hot topics. And then we move on to the next part of the show. But awesome. a lot of it is very ingrained in our training as lawyers. And so we have to, we acknowledge it, we tease ourselves, but we have to kind of dial it back at times.
Yeah. It's a question I ask friends who are, spouses or lawyers or mm-hmm. doctors, you'd think there'd be this higher level.
Oh yeah. It always goes back to the trash TV somehow. Mm-hmm. I don't know how, but it is what it is. Okay. So I think the last question I have on this topic, what's your advice for the lawyer that's watching right now and they're dreading their upcoming trial?
Wow. You're dreading an opportunity. Yeah, don't dread opportunities. The case has to go to trial. You want someone else to do it. You're afraid of losing. Losing is something you have to experience in order to know what it is to win. If you're dreading your upcoming trial and you need to put your phone down and go spend time with your client, you need to dive into this. You need to get out to the scene. You need to get this case into the cells in your body. And if you think you're going to lose it or you know you're going to lose it, well, and get in there and do your best and really prepare and put on the best trial that anyone could ever imagine. And then you'll be ready for the next one. This is an opportunity.
I love it. So I want to transition to probably what every plaintiff's lawyer wants to know. How much is their case worth in trying to figure that out? I feel like that's... Actually, I'm gonna backtrack a little bit. It's ironic. Whenever I'm talking to potential clients, what I've found is that potential clients never ask me, on that first phone call, at least, how much their case is worth. And this is something that I've stressed to the people on Law Venture, at least with my personal experience, is they're more concerned about their internal struggles and their internal stresses with the entire process and just not being taken advantage of. But at some point, it comes down to trying to figure out what the value is so you can figure out, you know, is your client getting something that's fair? I know insurance companies, they just put the medical bills in a computer system to help determine the value. But I also know from studying you that you have a more humanized and subjective approach. So can you talk about that?
Sure. Well, it depends, right? How much is their case worth? It depends a lot on you. How hard are you willing to fight? How far are you willing to go? How much are you willing to invest of your time, of your heart, of your soul, your money? Mm-hmm. That's going to decide how much a client's case is worth. And you know, people are going to tell you're crazy, but you know, the look on their faces when the juries read their verdict is, you know, nice thing to have in the memory center in your mind. So you gotta look at people and take those medical bills that you just talked about. Mm-hmm. Take them away. Insurance company evaluates the case that way. Take them away. Take them out of the equation. If you're looking at the medical bills and that's how you're evaluating your case, I think you're going about it the wrong way, unless it's just a medical bill case. Mm-hmm. The medical bills are paid and the lost earnings are paid. And you know, it's, I mean, this person's back to work and life's okay, then I guess it's an economic damages case. But otherwise, it's a, and the majority of these cases are, they're human loss cases. You know, they're damages to the quality of a person's life. Damage, you know, infliction of injury on their life, liberty, their ability to pursue happiness. And those are all priceless things, aren't they? Yeah, they're priceless. So if they're priceless, why are we going to put low numbers on those things? If we take something that is priceless and we damage it and we ruin it, then, you know, that thing now continues to exist for, you know, month after month, year after year, a lifetime. And you're called upon to answer the question, what is it worth? Well, start thinking big. Because it's priceless. So that's where you start.
I have so many questions about this. Let's start with this. Do you have to deal with an echo chamber of doubts of like juries don't do this, or that's too big of a number, that's too big of an ask?
No. Who are you listening to? Listen to people out there. I heard that. Growing up, oh boy, you know, there's this lawyer. He used to, heard him speak in law school, heard him speak as a young lawyer at some Boda thing that I went to. And he'd carry around a little pig with him. And he'd talk about lawyers asking for too much money. Mm. Oh boy, yeah, we don't want to turn off the jury. Well, you're going to turn off the jury if you're putting up numbers that you don't believe in, if you're putting up numbers that aren't reasonable. This whole idea or this concept you've heard, you know, of nuclear verdicts, right? It's not nuclear in the mind of the jury. Mm-hmm. Not in anybody's mind, just the insurance companies and their lawyers. They're people. And they are paid to diminish and, you know, beat down anything that our clients say is real. So, you know, if you listen to them, right, you listen to them, and you let that get inside you, that's going to affect you. Mm-hmm. You say, wow, you know, that's, you know what, yeah, maybe that's too much. But don't listen to the greedy people, you know, talking about what's greedy and what's too much. Mm-hmm. They have no say. They're not in a position to tell us what things are worth. We have to ask ourselves, ask each other. Talk openly about it. Talk to the jury about it. Just be open. And really, I mean, you get up there and you've got the, you know, the case that you're responsible for, and there's a dead child. That life was negligently taken, negligently killed, ruined, gone. You don't call it murder, but it's negligence. And the question is, what's the value of that child's life? Well, ask yourself this question. Years from now, am I going to be embarrassed that I didn't have the courage to tell the jury what it's really worth and what that jury verdict should have really been? This is your one opportunity. And just talk to them openly. Say, listen, you might agree, you might disagree. You might say it's worth less, you might say it's worth a whole lot more. It ought to at least be this. That's reasonable, and this is the reason why, and these are the reasons why, and here's the law, and here's the evidence, and here's what this life meant to this family, to this mom, to this dad. And you talk about it, and you believe it, and you feel it, and make sure that you don't put up a number that you're going to regret later on. Say, wow, I didn't have the courage to tell the jury what it was really worth. So start looking at it that way instead of the other way.
I love it. A lot of this community, I would categorize under being at the beginning stages of either their legal career or starting their own law firm. So for the lawyers that are cutting their teeth on cases where, let's say, the injuries and the non-economics are limited to however many months the client was treating, but the client has either made a full recovery or is doing fairly well, but let's say during those months wasn't doing so hot. Do you have the same philosophy and approach if it isn't as long-term?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can't tell you how many of those cases I've tried. Mm-hmm. When I was trying municipal court cases one after the other, week after week after week, mm-hmm. for years, you know, every once in a while I'd get a bigger one. Those are the cases that are going to give you the experience. You know, you're going to learn the procedure by doing smaller cases. Mm-hmm. And those smaller cases there, you know, that's a relative term, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Those cases are a big deal to those people who've had an intrusion into their lives. Who've had to go through something because of the negligence of another, and now they're having to go through a whole bunch more because of some shitbag insurance company that's not willing to treat them right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you know, focus on that time frame and really imagine what would it be worth? What would the amount of money be to not have to go through all of that? Mm-hmm. Right? I'd pay this much if there was, you know, $100,000 to not have to go through that 6-month period of my life, which was dark, which hurt, which was scary, which was lonely, stressful, inconvenient. Look at all the items of non-economic harm that your state will, you know, give you in the jury instructions to talk to a jury about. Mm-hmm. Inconvenience is a big one. And talk about what would it be worth? You know, every case is different, but it's not cheap.
Yeah.
Not cheap. But the other responsibility we have is we shouldn't be trying to make mountains out of molehills. Mm-hmm. Right? You got people that they get in a car wreck, they're hurt. You know, they, you know, see the billboard, they're like, wow, I don't know any better. And that lawyer, you know, gets them into chiropractors and this and that. All of a sudden they're on this course. And next thing you know, my neck still hurts. Next thing you know, they're getting injections. This is good for your case. Next thing you know, they're getting surgery. They're getting their body cut open when they shouldn't be having that done to them. Mm-hmm. That's a disgusting thing that our profession is part of. If you include those lawyers out there who do that as part of our profession, which I think we have to.
Absolutely.
And jurors know that. Jurors know that because maybe they've experienced or they've heard about it, or people they know and love have gone through that. So we have to make sure that those out there that are doing that stop.
And the best way to bulletproof it seems to be you need to know your client, right? You need to have that strong relationship with your client where you're looking out for the client, not overinflating the case. Yeah,
absolutely. And that's where the jury trial method is important, mm-hmm. because those lawyers out there who are running those cases, they're never going to step foot into a courtroom. Mm. So that's where we can set ourselves apart. Right? There's the business of law, and there are different ways that we can practice law and have a business, right? It could be small, it could be big, it could be a lot of different things. And then there's the professional component of it too. There's the ethics, and then there's being a trial lawyer and what that means. They're not all the same. So figure out who you want to be and be that person.
So my next question, I'm pretty sure the answer is always going to be, it depends on the case, but I'm curious on just what the philosophy and strategy is with providing, I guess, potential grounding on future non-economic damages, meaning is the strategy to provide a life care plan plus an economist so that there's a reference point for the jurors to use, or is there a different approach depending on the case?
No, I look at them separately, and I think that's a big mistake that lawyers have been making historically.
Okay.
Continue to make. You have to take non-economic damages. They are separate. It's a separate evaluation. They shouldn't have anything to do with what the economic damages are. Mm-hmm. Separate them out in your mind. Bifurcate them. Mm-hmm. Right? What's this worth? Because the economics, that's a whole separate analysis. And you can talk to the jury about it. It's a whole separate analysis. Mm-hmm. They've got people coming in. They're going to say that, and they say that, you know, it's really not $12 million. It's only three. It's only 3 million. So maybe you just pick a number in the middle and you go with that. Hope not. Go through an analysis. Look at it all. When you're looking at non-economic damages, that's something completely separate. Completely separate. There could be a case where the non-economic damages, the human losses, are worth little to zero. And the economic damages could be worth tens of millions of dollars or hundreds of millions or billions of dollars, mm-hmm. right? Because economic damage cases go on between corporations and insurance companies, et cetera, right? Non-economic damages don't exist. There could be a case where all the medical bills are absolutely paid. The person, you know, all the people that have to take care of the catastrophically injured human, right? They're all taken care of. Mm-hmm. But the catastrophically injured human is there alone. Mm-hmm. What's that human being's experience worth? The economic damages are not something that come into consideration when calculating the non-economics. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, the law would tell you to do it that way. Mm-hmm. So someone back there says, well, let's agree on this number and then just you know, double it, triple it, quadruple it. That's not the way to do it. Mm. And we shouldn't be doing it in our minds that way. The defense... And you know, they're smart to do it this way, and we allow it, mm-hmm. is they'll take these economics, right, that sometimes are inflated, mm-hmm. and they just tear that apart. And the whole fight is about this. The whole fight is about this. And you spend so much time fighting on that hill that you lose all your credibility with the jury. Mm. Now, when you go to talk about non-economics, you're a used car salesman over here. Mm. Don't make that mistake. Take it from someone who has, because that's how I was, you know, taught to try cases. So you got to put up the economics. And there's like, listen, after looking at all that and those medical bills, yeah, we believe she was hurt. We believe she, you know, yeah, she's got changes in her life, but we didn't believe anything you said after going through all these medical bills with all these referral doctors, you know, and there I am standing with a case that I, you know, was trying for some other law firm. Called me in at the last minute. I looked and I said, wow, I got to start doing this differently. Because at the end of the day, they get enough, you know, the firm gets enough money, right? The firm representing the plaintiff, they go, okay, how much for attorney's fees? How much for the doctors? And the human being who's had their experience, they're left with little to nothing. So we've got to change that. And if we change how we do it at the ground level, that'll change the industry. And that'll change how insurance companies evaluate people. How about sending a settlement opportunity letter? I don't call them demands, but you send a settlement opportunity letter just for non-economic damages. Here are the photos. Here's this, here's that. You don't you know, need a whole bunch of medical reports. Here's what happened. Pay your policy limits. They don't, you got an open policy. You think you got to wait to get all these reports and put together a packet with the economics? No, you do not.
I love that. I love that. I think an adjuster's mind is going to be blown if they don't see a single bill attached. They're not going to know what to do in that situation.
No, they won't.
It sounds like you're trying cases and obviously seeing some success where a single dollar isn't even being introduced as a bill, and whether it's future or past.
In case I tried in Iowa right before Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
You're familiar with that case. You can watch it on CBN. It's a pretty short med mal trial. There wasn't a single penny in economic damages in that case. Mm. Not a single penny. We just focused on, you know, what happened to Joseph Dudley.
Mm-hmm.
And what's that worth?
Man, Nick, you're going to make some lawyers get out of their comfort zone, man.
That's the only way to do it. Do you provide a formula for the jury? Yes. You know, sometimes you want to do it that, but sometimes you might just want to put it out there. What is it? What is it worth? If you were at an auction, right? Or there's we've all talked about the paintings, right? You've heard me do it. You've heard other people do it. But you know, you've got this one of a kind, priceless thing. Just talk about that, the value of that. You know, and you could compare it. Well, okay. You know, it's 20 years of life, 20 years of having a father, 45 years of, you know, pain in a body that isn't the same, a body that doesn't work. What's reasonable?
And if a defense lawyer comes back and says, like, look, they haven't provided a method, or, you know, where is this number coming from? They're just pulling it out of thin air. How do you handle that?
Yeah, depends on the moment.
Yeah.
Depends on the moment. You know, say, well, certainly not going to let them pull it out of thin air. Right?
Yeah.
You heard what they're doing and you understand why we're here.
Mm-hmm.
And the question we have is this, you know, should we treat this cheap?
Yeah.
This ought to be cheap. Should this ought to be low? You know, or is it more? Mm-hmm. Or do we really see the value?
Yeah.
The most precious things that have been taken, that have been ruined, that have been completely changed forever. If it was millions and millions of dollars,
mm-hmm,
in that big old truck, and they'd be pounding the table about getting their millions and millions of dollars back.
Mm-hmm.
Tens of millions. But what about the person inside? It'd be nice if we lived in a world where the person inside was worth more. So, a little idea on a case that I have coming up where there's a big Brinks truck that slammed into somebody.
I love it. I love it. Let's pivot very briefly to another topic that I feel like you're going to have some thoughts on, just because in both the books that I have behind me, it starts off pretty early on stressing the importance of lawyers taking care of their mental health and physical health. So can you provide some insights there?
Yeah. And I adopted that rule pretty quick. And I followed it throughout my life. And I think that's been a key ingredient to my success. I take care of my body, take care of my mind, and I can do my job.